started, there's this thing I always do whenever I go out to teach. I would love to put you through the introductory part of the cake baking, which I call my cake 101. I want you to know what cake is all about. So now when I go out, I always ask people, especially bakers, what is cake? And I get a lot of responses. Some people, you can sit please, you can sit if you're still standing. So I get these responses. Some people will tell me cake is food, cake is a sweet food, cake is a dessert, cake is a snack. But actually they are not far from the truth, but there are two key words we are expected to know when it comes to cake description. So if you're a baker and someone walks up to you and asks you, what is a cake? I know you'll be like, cake. But today I want to define what cake is. Actually, cake has to do with two key words. And these key two words are pastry and batter. So when you're asked to define what cake is, I expect you to say, cake is a kind of pastry that has to do with the formation and the baking of the batter. And you know, when you come to the pastry world, I think cake is so unique because if you see, I'll check out other pastries like bread, donuts, thin thin, meat pie and all that. We say bread dough, meat pie dough, thin thin dough. But when it comes to cake, we say cake batter. So what are these things that make up those cakes? That is what we call the ingredients. So look behind me, you'll see all these. They are all called ingredients. And I want to tell you, those ingredients are grouped into two groups. We have the key ingredients and we'll have the optional ingredients. So when it comes to the key ingredients, that is what we call the FEFS. F-E-F-S. And the full meaning of the FEFS F-S is flat. The E is for egg. The second F is for fat. And the X is for sugar. So now for this key ingredient, when it comes to flour, it's either you're baking with all-purpose flour, you're baking with cake flour, then when it comes to, okay, you're also baking with self-raising or self-rising flour. So the difference between those self-raising flour and the all-purpose flour is that for the self-raising or self-rising flour, you don't need to add any raising agent. Already is in it, so no need. So when it comes to the E, which is the egg, it's either you're baking with a small egg or the medium-sized egg or the large size. Then when it comes to the fat, we now have the margarine, the butter, the oil, and the vegetable shortening. And when it comes to the egg, sugar, we have lots of them. You can bake with the mother of all sugars, which is the white granulated sugar. You can bake with the brown sugar, which is also called the muscadavo sugar. You can bake with the icing sugar, which is called the confectioner sugar, and you can bake with the caster or castor sugar, the finest texture sugar you can ever see. So that is all about the key ingredients. And when it comes to the optional ingredients, we have some of these ingredients. Yeah, they are optional, but at the same time, they are necessary. That is where we have ingredients like the milk, the yogurt, as you can see. But we have Hollandia milk here, we have Hollandia yogurt here. So I want you to stay ahead with the dairy. I'm going to start ahead with the dairy power. So if you're a baker in Nigeria, you have to start using Hollandia milk. I'll be teaching you how to bake with Hollandia milk and how to bake with Hollandia yogurt. So when it comes to the cream, we also have the heavy cream as well. Then we have another optional ingredient, the flavor. So now we have two different categories of flavor. It's either you're baking with the flavor essence or you're baking with the flavor extract. So now the difference between the two is that for the essence, it's low in concentration, it's very, very mild. And when it comes to the extract, it's high in concentration, it's kind of harsh. So if a recipe calls for 1 tablespoon of flavor essence and what you have is extract, all you need to do is to reduce the quantity. So you either use maybe 2 teaspoons of the extract or just 1/2 tablespoon of that extract. So for flavors as well, we have different kinds of flavors. We have the friendly flavors, which I call the versatile flavors. We have the unfriendly flavors, which I call the harsh flavors. and we have the dry flavor or the powdered flavors. Then lastly, we have the purposeful or the conventional flavors. I know someone will be wondering, what's he even saying? But I want you to know what cake is all about. So when you see yourself outside as a baker, you know what you're using to bake and their functions. So now, for the friendly flavors, that is where we'll have the vanilla flavor. The vanilla is the most versatile flavor you can ever imagine or have. Then we'll have the milk flavors. Then when it comes to the unfriendly flavors, all the fruit flavors, orange, strawberry, banana, lemon, all of them fall under that category. They are harsh flavors. You don't use them single-handedly. You have to mix them with the friendly flavors to blend it in your cake. So when it comes to the purposeful flavors or conventional flavors, that is where I have to say, I'm baking chocolate cake, I'm baking chocolate flavor. I'm baking coconut cake, I'm using chocolate flavor, sorry. So that takes us to the dry flavors as well. That is where we have the cocoa powder, the desiccated coconut, the mixed spices, the nutmeg, and all that. So that is that about flavors. Then we also have some other optional ingredients like the resin agent. When it comes to baking powder is a resin agent, and there are two types of baking powder. We have the single acting baking powder, and we have the double acting or double active baking powder. Both of them, they perform the same function, but they are different. So if a recipe calls for single acting baking powder, you want to use 1 tablespoon of single acting baking powder. That means if you have double acting baking powder, you need to reduce the quantity because it's hard. So you're going to step down on the quantity. Maybe you now use 1/2 tablespoon. So the reason why we call it the double acting, when you go to the market, look at the tin of the baking powder you're buying, you will see double acting baking powder. It reacts twice. When it comes in contact with anything fused, it reacts. Then when it enters into the oven as well, it reacts. So that is that about the baking powder. Then we also have the baking soda, and we have the cream of tartar. Then there are other optional ingredients like the food color, the browning, and lots of them. So I don't want to bore you, and it's time for us to enter into the deal of the day. It's time for us to start up. So we are going to do this together. So the first thing I'm going to do before we start up is to light our oven, and that process is called preheating process. So let me do, let's light up our oven.